students. My name is Dr. Emmanuel Maria. I'm from the Department of Political Science and Public Administration. Today, we will be discussing issues related to organization theory and public bureaucracy. This is OPA 102. So, I'm looking forward for you to enjoy this lecture and learn a lot of issues related to organization theory and public bureaucracy. Let us start. The course objective is to help participants develop abilities to analyze complex organization systems using multiple theoretical frameworks. So, the course will present the fundamental concepts of the organization theory and bureaucracies by using various approaches and different theoretical frameworks. Organizations have become the mainstay of human lives, as it was pointed out by a very important scholar known as Amitai Etzion, who said, "We are born in organization, live and work in organization, and when we die, we will get our last service in organizations." So, organizations are very important. Families are organizations. We are formal and informal organizations. For us, our concentration today, or our focus, will be formal organizations. So, think about any form of organization. If you are in the church, you are in an organization. In a mosque, you are in an organization. Any other institution, you are in an organization. You are bound by an organization. You are born within an organization. So, it is really an interesting subject which touches all of our lives. So, let us visit several definitions of an organization. We don't have a single definition. We have several definitions. But I will touch few of them. According to Lino, this is a scholar, he said an organization is a system of two or more persons engaged in cooperative action, trying to reach some purpose. That means there should be a purpose, a goal, something we want to achieve at the end. Organizations are a bounded system of structured social interaction featuring authority, relations, communication systems, and use of incentives. We can look at a dictionary. Business Dictionary says a social unit of people that is structured and managed to meet a need or to pursue collective goals. Now, what are the key important points? First, you have people, more than one individual, but you have goal to be attained. So an organization doesn't need to exist for the sake of it. Even a criminal organization, gangs, are organizations. They have a purpose. They are thieves. They want to accumulate wealth through bad ways. But it's an organization, but a criminal organization. So, organizations play an important role in our lives, as I said earlier. This is even more so with the growth of large-scale business organizations and diverse ownership for management. We generally live in an organization world. Organizations of one form or another are a necessary part of our society and serve many important needs. So, what is the theory of organization then? Organization theory refers to a set of interrelated concepts and definitions that explain the behavior of an individual or individuals or groups or subgroups who interact with each other to perform the activities intended towards the accomplishment of a common goal. In other words, the organization theory studies the effect of social relationships between the individual with their organization along with their actions on the organization as a whole. So, defined differently by different scholars, it can be looked at differently by political scientists, sociologists, management scientists, and economists. All these have studied the concept. So, political scientists identify bureaucracy as the administration of the state, while the economists, they use this term to describe non-market organizations. So, various scholars have various definitions for the concept of bureaucracy. So, for political scientists, they normally associate bureaucracy with the state, administration of the state, the government institutions. For example, we could consider the Open University bureaucracy, a bureaucratic organization. The same with NCCF, it's also a bureaucratic organization. So, bureaucracy, as per the political scientist, it deals with all organizations of the state. So, this lecture focuses on defining bureaucracy as defined by Max Weber. It is written Weber, but it is pronounced Weber. This guy was a German scientist, a sociologist, who lived between 1864 and 1920. So, as I told you, we have several definitions, but I will focus on the definition by Max Weber, a German sociologist. Bureaucracy is an organizational structure that is characterized by many rules, standardized processes, procedures, and requirements. Number of desks, meticulous division of labor and responsibility, clear hierarchy, and professional, almost impersonal interaction between employees. So, bureaucracy has to do with rules and regulations, rational procedures. Bureaucracy is the basis for the systematic formation of any organization and is designed to ensure efficiency and economic effectiveness. The basic principles of bureaucracy are division of labor, hierarchy, rules, and impersonal relationships. So, let us look at various characteristics of bureaucracy. We talk about task specialization. That means you specialize in certain tasks. Tasks are divided into simple routine categories on the basis of competencies and functional specializations. You see, you have an engineer, you have an IT expert. That is specialization. You don't do everything, but you specialize in certain tasks. So with the bureaucracy, that is very important. Another one is hierarchical of authority. You have a hierarchy of authority. For example, the Open University, you have the vice chancellor. First of all, you have the chancellor. You have the vice chancellor. You have the deputy vice chancellors. You have the directors and deans. You have the head of departments and what have you. That is hierarchical order from the top to the bottom. Third, you have selection, formal selection. Employees are not just selected for the sake of it. All employees are selected on the basis of technical skills and competencies, which have been acquired through training, education, and experience. That's why when we need, for example, an IT expert, we will make an announcement, we will advertise, then they will come. We will do what? We will interview them. So, formal selection. You don't just come and say, okay, I want to join this institution. No. Or you have your friend, I'm the boss, I have my friend, I bring them. That is not bureaucracy. Bureaucratic organization follow formal processes of recruitment of employees. Then you have another characteristic, which is rules and requirements. All bureaucratic institutions have rules and regulations. For example, the Open University has rules on how to employ employees, have rules on study leave for employees. So formal rules and requirements are required to ensure uniformity so that employees know exactly what is expected of them. In person, what does it mean? Regulations and clear requirements create distant and impersonal relationship between employees, with the additional advantage of preventing nepotism or involvement from outsiders or politics. That means, for example, if you come to the office of the Vice Chancellor, it is not Professor Misanda, rather it is his office. So he performs as per the office. It's not that he decides because he's Professor Misanda. When Professor Misanda is at home, he cannot call me and say, okay, come at my home and wash my room. No. He will act as per the office. So, impersonality. That's why when he's not there, somebody will deputize. When that somebody deputizes, he works in that office. That's what we call impersonal. There is career orientation. Employees of a bureaucratic organization are selected on the basis of their expertise. As a result, there is a possibility of lifetime employment. That means you come to an organization as a novice, you grow, as time goes, you acquire skills, and you grow career-wise. So, it's different with the other organization, whereby you have no chance or the possibility of growing in terms of career is very minimal or limited. So, dear students, maybe I should ask you, I have explained a lot of issues related to organization, bureaucracy, and organization theory. I would like you to take note of this, or ask yourself, or identify advantages and disadvantages of bureaucracy. That is something you should try to go, read books, find out what are the advantages and disadvantages of bureaucracy. Now, let us see quickly the difference or the relationship between public bureaucracy and private organizations. That means, as I said earlier, political scientists normally associate bureaucracy with government institutions or with the government or state organizations. So, first of all, that public interest differ from private interest, since the public sector must consider a broader set of norms and values. Many considerations must be weighed against each other, and democratic considerations, constitutional values, and public welfare are given much more weight in public organizations than in private organizations. So, a public organization normally takes care of the whole community, the values, the interests of the public, while a private organization normally goes for profit maximization. Hence, public interest is not a priority. Second, the leaders of public organizations are accountable to citizens and voters rather than special groups. For example, the president of this country is dedicated to the well-being of all Tanzanians, while a CEO of a public organization or of a private organization much interested with the interest of shareholders. So it's all about profit. It's not about everybody. It's all about profit. So third, public organizations require a greater emphasis on the openness, transparency, equal treatment, impartiality, and predictability. You are sure if you come to an open university, you will be able to see maybe the vice chancellor, you will be able to see the deputy vice chancellor, or you will be able to serve by head of departments. There is this certainty. You know, The fee is maybe 10 million, 5 million, 6 million. The fee is fixed. But with private organization, that is not the case. This openness, transparency, equal treatment, impartiality, and predictability is a core value of all public institutions. As opposed to this direction is tradition within organization theory that reject the concept, the conception as stereotype. There are other scholars now who say no, there is no difference between public and private institutions. They say when you differentiate them, this is a stereotype. So it is stated that variables such as size, task, and technology can influence organization more than their private or public status does. So for them, they consider size, technology, and other factors more than distinguishing organization as public and private. So again, I give you a task or an activity. Can you identify the major arguments of universalist scholars? Those who say, no, you don't have private or public. You just own organization, you have organizations in terms of technology, size, etc. I hope you can now see the difference between public and private organization. Now, let us go to the theories of organizations. We have various approaches towards organizations. We have several theories which try to talk about organization or explain a number of issues related to organizations. They are the classical or traditional theory, the human relation or neoclassical theory, the decision-making theory, the system approach, and contingency approach. Let us start with classical theories. Classical organization theory includes the scientific management approach, Weber's bureaucratic approach, and the administrative theory. These theories are advocated by various scholars. Frederick W. Taylor, Henry Fayol, and Max Weber, as I said. These are scholars who advocate classical theories of organization. We have many other theories which form, or theorists who have advocated classical theories. However, I've mentioned only those theories. The main pillars of classical theories are as follows. One, division of labor. In order to obtain a clear specialization in order to improve the performance of individual workers, the organization must divide work. Okay? You have an IT expert, you have an administrator. They represent division of work within an organizational setting. We have what we call departmentalization. The organization must group the various activities and jobs into departments. This allows it to minimize cost and also facilitate administrative control. Let us take an example of the Open University. We have several departments at the Open University. We have Department of Accounts. We have a Department of Public Administration, for example, where it comes to academics. We have a Department of Sociology. So these are departments within an organization. Another is coordination. The organization must ensure harmony and diverse functions. This allows it to arrange the group effort in an orderly manner, which provides unity of action while pursuing common purpose. What does this mean? We all have a certain direction to follow, or we want to achieve certain goals. Now this needs coordination. You have to coordinate all activities in order to achieve a set of organizational goals. Another is scalar and functional processes. A scalar chain is the series of superior subordinate relationships from the top to the bottom in an organization. It facilitates the delegation of authority or command communication or feedback, and also remedial action or dedication. All these bureaucratic organizations have a chain of command where you have at the top, you have the bosses, then you have directors, departments, etc. This is all we call scalar chain. Structure. Structure is the logical relationship of functions in an organization. Further, these functions are arranged for effective objective accomplishment of task. We have also span of control. This is the number of subordinates that a manager can effectively supervise. For example, Department of Accounting can have a number of, can have the director or the manager who supervises three individuals or four individuals. So the span of control is related to the number of subordinates a manager who under a certain manager or a certain supervisor. Now, like any other theory, it has its advantages and disadvantages. So there are scholars who have come up with, they have criticized this. So we are looking at the criticism of the classical organization theory. First of all, they say it takes a rigid well as a static view of organization. The organization is seen as static, pre-arranged, predetermined. You have rules and regulations. You have to follow a certain way. That is static, so it is a little bit rigid. Most classical theorists view an organization as a closed system with no interaction with its environment. They take an organization as if it is it survives in isolation. For example, the Open University doesn't survive in isolation. The Open University survives within an external and internal environment. For example, the Open University is affected by the external environment, Ministry of Education, the student we get from the secondary schools. All this, the technology we use, it is not from within, it's from outside. So when you take an organization in isolation, that is a big criticism of this theory. The theory focuses more on structural and also technical aspects of organizations. It is based on oversimplified and mechanistic assumptions. Individuals within organizations have feelings. Individuals within organizations need to be motivated. But this theory focuses on structures. It is that rigid, such an extent that it ignores the human relation within the organization. After saying that, let us look at another theory. This is another approach to organization theory. This is the human relation or neoclassical theory. The human relation theory, also known as neoclassical theory, said that while designing an organization structure, the people who are employed there and their behavior should be taken into consideration. No manager can think solely of job description. He has also to think of why people behave as they do and what influences their behavior. For example, individuals, associates. Individuals sometimes are happy, sometimes are unhappy. There are formal and informal relations within an organization. So, to human relations, these are very important for the prosperity of an organization or enables the organization to achieve organizational goals. If managers within an organization, they don't care of human relations within an organization, the organization is going to fail or will not be as efficient as it's supposed to be. So, who is the scholar, the main propagator of this theory is called Elton Mann. He is considered the father of this theory, of this approach, human relation approach. There are many other scholars. Kindly read books, visit the literature to know them. Elton Mann came up with what Hawthorne studies and many subsequent ones have shown that the way people behave at work is affected by many other factors than monetary consideration. You know, classical theorists normally talk about rewarding people And most when you think of rewarding people, it's all about monetary incentives. However, as I said earlier, there are more other factors which make people perform better within an organization or within an organization. The other approach to this, to organization, is the decision-making theory. This was propagated by a scholar known as Herbert Simon, regarded organization as a structure of decision makers. In an organization, the decisions are made at all levels, and important decisions tend to be made at the higher levels. The decision-making approach to organization accepts that hierarchical form of organization. Hence, the structure of the organization reflects the point to which decisions are made. So, for him, for Herbert Simon and his theory, he focuses on the levels where decisions are made, at the top, at the bottom, at the center. So, to him, the approach to organization focuses on points where decisions are made. Then we have the system approach. The system approach looks at organization as a total system comprising a number of interacting variables. As I said earlier, organizations do not exist in isolation. They exist in an environment, internal and external environment. So, let us again take an example of the Open University. The Open University gets inputs from the environment. The inputs are the students. Then the inputs are processed. When they are processed, they get out as graduates. They are called outputs. Then the graduates will go and work in the environment. We'll have an outcome. An outcome will lead to what we call we have an outcome, then you have impact. Now, with the system approach, there is this feedback. The environment will give feedback to the organization. You have good students. No, your students don't perform. So, the organization operates within a system. This approach emphasizes that we should not deal with problems in isolation, but consider their interactions. In fact, the word system means a regularly interacting or interdependent group of items forming a unified whole. Another theory or approach to organization is a contingency approach. This, generally, we call it a situational approach. It is based on the premise that methods or behaviors which work effectively in one situation fail in another. You see, with the classical theorists, they believe on regulations, rules, in one way, the best way. However, sometimes you have to perform as per the situation. So, for example, you cannot say, I have lost maybe my uncle. You say, okay, it is stipulated by the law that you cannot go home because your uncle passed away. No. You act as per the situation. If you are a manager, you consider the situation. So it is called a situational approach, OTS. Results differ because situations differ. The manager's task, therefore, is to identify which method will work in a particular situation and a particular circumstances and at a particular point, in time. Best contribute to the attainment of organizational goals. So you don't act rigidly, rather you work as per the situation. So, dear students, we have gone through a number of approaches to organization theory approaches to organization, and we have seen them. It is now your duty to go revisit the literature and read more, so in order to understand all these concepts and all these theories. Now, let us see. We have formal and informal organizations. I will focus on formal organizations. Formal organization is a well-defined structure of authority and a responsibility that defines delegation of authority and relationship among the organization members. It works along predetermined or predefined set of policies, plans, procedures, schedules, and programs. Most of the decisions in formal organization are based on predetermined policies. So what are the features of formal organizations? There are several features of formal organization. As I said, we have a formal organization, but here we are looking at the features of formal organization. These are deliberately created in order to help those particular organizations achieve certain goals. It is deliberately created structure that defines official relationships amongst people working in different job positions. You have people in the Department of Accounting, you have people in the Department of Finance, for example. Now, they are defined structures in order for these people to operate efficiently and effectively within those positions. Then another feature is job-oriented. It focuses more on jobs than people. A formal organization focuses more on people and on jobs rather than people. It allocates job to people. You see, you have the position of the VC. It is a position, it is a job. Then people are allocated to that particular job. It's not that we say, Anton. No, we start with the position, then Anton fills that position. So jobs, job-oriented. Division of work. Work is divided into smaller units and assigned to individuals on the basis of their skills and their abilities. Division of work results in specialization and increases organizational output. So it is very important for formal organization to give tasks as per the skills of individuals who are assigned to those tasks. Further, we have departmentalization or departmentation. Department or departmentation is the foundation of organization structure. That is, organization structure depends upon departments. Departments refer to division of work into smaller units and they are regrouping into bigger units, departments, on the basis of similarity of activity. So departments are assigned as per the activities, uniform or activities which are related. You don't put different activities which are related into one department. It will be chaos. Formal authority. People exercise their authority by virtue of their position in the organizational hierarchy. Authority is linked to the position and through it in the position, through it in the person occupying the position. It involves the right to command, to perform, to make a decision, and spend resources. For example, maybe Dr. Maria is the director of consultants. Okay. It is not Mario. He performs as per the position. For example, if we are on a holiday, somebody else will perform, will act in that position, will deputize in that position. So it is the position. Formal authority is per the position and not per individual. You cannot say, okay, if your tenure is gone, then somebody else will come in that position and acquire that authority. So the vice chancellor has the authority, not because of himself, rather because of the position. Delegation. Work is officially delegated from top to lower levels. The workload is divided into units. A part is assigned to subordinates with the authority to carry. To carry out tasks assigned to them by their superior. The concept of division of work and its assignment to people down the scala chain is called delegation. So, superiors will delegate power to their subordinates or to the lower level positions. That is what we call delegation. We have another characteristic of formal organization, and this is coordination. Managers integrate the activities of individuals and units into a concerted effort so that departments and individuals work toward a common goal. Communication of organizational goals is vital and an important duty of all managers. So, coordinate, a superior will communicate what the subordinates are supposed to do. So it is very important for superiors to clearly communicate organizational goals and objectives to their subordinates. And this communication, if it is clear enough, it will enable organization to achieve its goals. Principle of organizing. Formal organization is based on firm principles of organizing, that is, unity of objectives, organizational efficiency, division of labor, authority, responsibility, delegation, scale of change, span of control, unit of command, balance, flexibility, continuity, exception, simplicity, departmentation, decentralization, unity of direction, and cooperation. All these concepts, all these form what we call principle of organizing. So, like I said earlier, what are the advantages of having formal organization? There are merits, of course, and demerits. It is, first of all, it clearly defines the objective of the organization and authority, responsibility, relationship among people to attain those objectives. It results in optimum utilization of scarce organizational resources. Within formal organization, because there are structures, because there are departments, because there are formal structures which are clearly known, then resources are well used. Division of work and the relationships amongst people develop effective system of communication in the organization. When you have clear defined structures, then it is easy to be effective and easy to communicate. The organizational hierarchy avoids overlapping of activities between two individuals or two departments. Two individuals are not assigned the same task. If there are no departments, no specialization, there is no clear structures, then you will have conflicts within the organization because people will be complaining to each other, will be complaining that somebody is doing their jobs because there won't be a clear structure. There are no clear structures or clear boundaries. With formal organization, as I said earlier, there is a possibility of having growth in terms of career. You grow. Career advancement and promotional avenues are clearly defined in the formal structure of an organization. You are employed as a tutor, then you can grow to an assistant lecturer, to a lecturer, to a senior lecturer, okay? Then to a professor, to assistant professor, associate professor, to a professor. There is a clear path of growth. The rate of absenteeism and the labor turnover, the rate at which people join and leave the organization remains low because of clear objectives, policies, and strategies. Remember, when you have a formal organization, these people have a certain level of certainty, so they will remain with an organization for a long time. So turnover, labor turnover, is a little bit lower. Formal organization integrates formal goals of the organization with goals of individuals working in the organization. There is thus synthesis of individual group and organizational goals. So, those are the advantages of having a formal organization. However, as in the area, as I said earlier, there are also limitations, all the limitations of formal organizations. The limitation has loss of initiative. It's like an employee is programmed. Too much emphasis is placed upon formal rules and regulations. Workers do not use their creativity and innovation skills to perform organizational goals. You know you have to do this and that as per the procedures. There's no room for innovation. Unsatisfied social needs. Man is a social being. He needs to interact with people and share his feelings at work and off work with others. So when there are formal rules and procedures, he cannot willingly and freely interact. Then he becomes, he is limited. So formal, I would like to now conclude. Formal organizations, they are generally there to provide services and products to the environment. Services, educational services. Products, there are a number of products. It can be food products. There can be other products which the community or society needs. Formal organizations provide services and goods or products. They normally operate within internal and external environment, and their operations are affected or determined accordingly. As I said earlier, formal organizations, they don't exist in isolation. They are within the environment, external and internal. So they are affected by external environment and internal environment. Now, quickly, the informal organizations are regarded as those type of organizations or activities without conscious joint purpose, even though possibly contributing to joint results. So, informal organization, there is no formal arrangement. People just meet and perform certain tasks. Sometimes you find in an organization which you are not, you don't even want to be there, or you are just there. For example, if you are traveling with a plane, you are there. It's an organization, but an informal one. So, having said that, I would like to quickly take you back to what we have discussed today. We have seen what is an organization. First of all, it is all about organization theory and public democracy, which to us is a code, a course known as OPA 102. We introduced the concept of organization. We saw various definitions of organizations. We went through the concept of bureaucracy and various theories related to organization, or various approaches to organization. Then we finally concluded with the concept of formal organization. Having said that, I would like you to go through all this, revisit the literature, and enhance your knowledge on those areas. Thank you very much for listening.